It's time for the KVOK podcast. Music, entertainment, interviews, and shenanigans. You never know what you're going to hear on this podcast.
It was fun for a little boy, but it was hell for a man to be Hank Williams.
Here I am, about 19 years old, and I said, yeah, well, I hope your old plane crashes. And God almighty, for years I thought I caused it.
Besides the whiskey, I think we'll require a little respect.
I hate rude behavior in a man. Won't tolerate it.
Oh, I figure we'll get out about the same time in there. Probably Trigger will outlast me, I think. We're both pretty old.
Now, here are your hosts, Nick Dunham, Joe Hawley, and Brett Modlin.
Welcome into the KVOK podcast. Nick Dunham, Joel Hawley, and Brett Modlin here with you. As you can tell by the opening there, if you know your music, that's Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Yeah.
That's what we're going to be covering today, tonight, this evening on the podcast, whenever you're listening to it. We appreciate you downloading and listening to it. Be sure to tell your friends about the podcast, subscribe, review, all that good stuff. Now that we got that out of the way, how are y'all doing?
All right, man.
I had to drive through quite a bit of fog to get here to this evening.
It was a foggy, foggy.
It was like if you're in the woods, you'd be waiting for like a werewolf to show up. That kind of fog.
Children of the Corn kind of stuff.
It was spooky.
It was a little bit. A little bit today, but I'm kind of...
Other than that, I'm good.
Yeah. Kind of excited for this one. This is a iconic band right here.
It is. You know, and I know we watch different documentaries to do our, mm-hmm. our research on it, and from listening to yours, your description, I somehow got off on the wrong one. It had lots of interviews, and it was pretty informative. It was 3 hours long. You would think a 3 hour documentary is, you know, it's going to have everything you could possibly want to know about the subject in there. But it was lacking somewhat. Although the interviews were interesting from the But they did this thing throughout the thing where somebody would say in an interview, they'd say, well, and then we went over here and did this. And then the next interview would be, and then, no, we didn't do that. So there was a lot of that, you know, kind of mean, too, because they would play, I mean, purposely.
So there were some discrepancies in some of the stories.
There was a lot of, and most of it came from, before we get into that, I guess we can kind of start talking about where this band came from and when. I think when was kind of amazed that that Lynyrd Skynyrd started in 1964.
Yeah. You don't think
of them as being a band. I mean, obviously they didn't have any hits or I don't think they didn't even record in the 60s.
Right.
But yeah, they were technically playing. Know, they were playing.
And they were honing their skills, man.
They were called, you know, they had the band name and
sure.
I don't know when they wrote the songs that were on their first album, but, I just thought that was interesting. You know, obviously from Jacksonville, Florida.
If they started in 1964, uh-huh. started playing as a band and everything. So roughly guessing, wasn't it around 74 when they actually first put out their album, their very first album, and had several hits on it? I believe it was 1974, and I'm not trying to skip ahead.
No, I think I think their first album came out prior to that.
Yeah.
Was
yeah,
it?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they're basically a bar band.
Either way, you know you're going to have to put a lot of years in, man. I mean, not very many bands hit it big real quick. They usually play for quite a while before they
hit. Eight years is
that's quite a long
time.
You know? That's quite a while, man.
I guess they were able to make money playing around touring and everything. Yeah. But that's
and plus timing, man. Mm-hmm. Timing is a big thing to do with that, because I mean they were a Southern rock band, and maybe they still had that. Maybe they originally had that Southern rock sound, but people really didn't dig it as much. Maybe locals did.
Well, I don't know if there's any recordings from their, you know, from the early days. There might be some out there, but
1973 is when the first album came.
So 9 years. Boy, but I was close. It was close.
If you believe the documentary that I watched, anyway. Ronnie Van Zant's big influence was his first big musical influence was the Stones. And a buddy saw the Rolling Stones and would have been 64, mm-hmm. which is really that was it. The documentary talked about how when he was a kid, he was kind of came from a rough part of town, had kind of a rough upbringing, and was a tough kid. You know, he was good at fighting.
I heard he was kind of a bully.
Well, he wasn't a huge guy, but nobody
messed with him.
He was one of those guys that knew how to street fight.
Sure, yeah. Sure.
And
I think the term they used in the documentary I watched was double tough.
Double tough?
Double tough.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a good guy. Not a guy that you'd want to attend.
That does make sense with them being a Rolling Stones fan, because, you know, Rolling Stones did kind of – they were pretty heavily influenced by honky-tonk music.
Sure.
And the rebel side. So that does kind of make sense, and I know Ronnie Van Zant pretty much he was the one that called all the shots. I mean, basically a lot of it went right through him, had to be okayed through him and everything, because he was the mastermind behind the band.
Yeah, he was the guy,
Gary Rossington. Yeah,
he was the guy. I think they had the dream, because he and the documentary I watched, they talked about when he was a kid, he wanted to be a football player. That was his big thing. Mm-hmm. And his first play, he played running back. His first play, snapped his ankles.
Oh, double tough wasn't.
So his ankles apparently weren't double tough. They were double broke. And then his next thing, he wanted to be a boxer. He really loved Muhammad Ali, Cassius Clay at that time. And the first time he went to go spar or something, he got the shit kicked out of him. And, mm-hmm. and that was the end of that. And so then his next dream was, after he saw the Rolling Stones, so he wanted to be a rock and roll star.
Now he wanted to be a lover, not a fighter.
Well, yeah, he was not. Well, he liked.
I know they played in some pretty rough bars. You know,
he was more of a, like I said, more of a street fighter. He wasn't, you know, get in the ring and go up.
Which kind of brings us up to the next thing. You know, structured. I mean, with them playing in so many bars and everything, and I'm sure it was rough and rowdy times then. They had to change their band name several times.
Yeah, they did. Before we jump on that, though, on Brett's note about musical influences, I don't know if they covered this in your documentary or not, but the research that I did, they talk about Son House, the old blues singer, was a major influence on Ronnie Van Zant.
No, they talked about the Stones influence and like Joel mentioned, the country influence and standard blues. Mm-hmm. But didn't get into specific blues artists. Like something.
That makes sense that they were influenced. They had some blues there because, you know, Mr. Banker and Rayford.
Oh, sure. A lot of their songs are just, you know, basic
Four Walls
blues.
Of Rayford. I mean, those are blues songs.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, so, they had to have some blues influence there.
In the late, I guess what this would have been late 60s, Ronnie Van Zant became a huge fan of Free. The rock band from England with Paul Rodgers. He just loved, how do you not love Paul Rodgers' voice? It's phenomenal. And he couldn't mimic necessarily Paul Rodgers, but that was the tone and that was the thing he was going for vocally. And that was even before they had gotten a record deal or anything.
So before we dive into this, I got a question. You guys watch documentaries.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I didn't get to watch Shinola. Uh-huh. But did either one of y'all happen to catch why he would perform barefooted every time? Because I've always heard through the grapevine and everything, it was his means of feeling the moment. Barefoot on the stage.
No,
say anything about that?
No, they touched on him playing barefoot, but they never gave a reason for it. They just the way they got into that part is they said that one of the guys talking on there was what I like about him is he wasn't up there shimmying and shaking.
Oh, that's for sure.
He stood there barefooted and planted and held that microphone like he was holding his ground.
You know, it was weird. There were guys in this documentary I watched, and they were interviewing him in the early days, and they could just talk about how commanding he was from the stage and everything. And I guess he was, but then they show later live clips of them right. in concert. And you're right. He didn't move anywhere.
No, he was more like the drum major, man. He was calling out orders.
Well, he was, but I mean, he didn't.
When he would look at one, they would know what to do.
His emoting from the stage was all very subtle. And, you know, it was all in his face. Sure. It was all in his, mm-hmm. his voice. Mm-hmm. And he sometimes would have the hat, you know, the hat on. It was covering his face, even, mm-hmm. you know, covering his eyes. It was all. I mean, he definitely had a stage presence, but it was not like a. It certainly wasn't a Mick Jagger type where he's all over the
place.
Oh,
right, right. Yeah. He didn't work the stage.
He did it. Well, he did right. it in his own way. He was very, very subdued about it and bit powerful.
Well, the dude could sure swing the mic stand. I know that. I've seen a lot of videos with him swinging that thing around, you know, and everything. That's pretty cool. I mean, it's just talent.
Well,
trademark.
You don't really have to do cartwheels on stage. No. You got a band that phenomenal.
Oh, that's true. His guitarist, his band members more than made up for it.
Exactly.
They were very active on moving around on the stage.
Which there was an Oki in there. So we'll talk about that here in a little bit.
Yeah, we'll get to that. In the early stages, actually the first time that they played together, one of the things, it's funny because you were mentioning football and boxing. And the research that I did, I didn't come up with any of that, so I was glad to hear that. What I heard was that one of the first times they met was at a baseball game. And Ronnie had hit a line drive out and actually hit Bob Burns, the drummer, the future drummer at that point, hit him in the show. There's conflicting
stories
there, yeah. One says it hits him in the shoulder, and the other one says it actually hit him in the head. But then Ronnie Van Zant walks over to him. He's like, sorry about that, kid. And then they became friends after that and got to talking about music and everything, and they ended up meeting at his house and playing under the carport. And I guess they played Time Is On My Side as the first song they ever played together.
Well, the one that I watched had an interview with Robert Burns, right, the drummer?
Yeah, yep.
And this is the interview was done right maybe a year or so, before he passed away.
Mm-hmm.
And he claims that he was in another band. Ronnie Van Zant was in a band. And Ronnie Van Zant they had played a show together, like a battle of the bands type thing. Mm. And Ronnie Van Zant saw that other band and compared his. So these guys aren't cutting it. They're not at that level. So Robert Burns claims that one morning he heard this knocking on his front door, and he opens it up and it's Ronnie Van Zant, and he's like, dude, I don't want to fight you, because that's what he thought. He's coming over to kick my ass for whatever reason. He goes, no, I'm not here. I'm not here to fight you. I want you to be in my band. And that's how the band started, according to that interview. But he was the one that they contradicted a lot throughout. Mm-hmm. He would say something, and then they'd have somebody else give a completely different story.
And we'll get into it later. But
well, I know he pieced it all together.
He's a character.
He pieced the whole band together.
Sure. Yeah. He
handpicked each person. Yeah. So.
Well, yeah. It was all guys within a couple miles of his house.
But he knew what he wanted. He knew the sound that he wanted.
Yeah.
And he strived for that.
But I would imagine they were probably horrible when they first started, because they were kids. Mm-hmm. They didn't know how to play anything. So it took them 8 years to get to the point where they could, you know, they could not only write songs, but then be able to perform them.
So the original band members were Ronnie Van Zant, Gary Rossington, Alan Collins, Bob Burns, and Larry Junstrom. That's the core, the original, the starting point anyway, from the research study. Does that match up with what you got?
Yeah, pretty much. But the Sweet Home Alabama version of them that you think of, I don't think there was one member in there that you mentioned that probably wasn't in the band at that time.
Ed King?
No.
Okay.
I don't think he even had joined
at
that time.
Right.
But anyway, so they do their thing, and they start playing around, start getting a reputation as a good band. Around the same time, this is late 60s, early 70s, the Allman Brothers are starting to hit. And from what I got from the movie I watched, that they had Lynyrd Skynyrd and Allman Brothers had kind of a competition. And Lynyrd Skynyrd, because they didn't hit first, they kind of felt inferior to Allman Brothers band, so much so that they had an opportunity to sign with their label, the same label that Allman Brothers won. They didn't want to do it because they were like, we want to be lumped in with them. We want to do our own thing. We want to be separate from them. They did finally agree, but one of the things that they said is we're only going to commit to doing two shows with the Allman Brothers. That's it. And the rest of the time we want to do our own thing. They're very sensitive to not, they didn't want to ride on their coattails of being this, you know, the Southern, they didn't want to be like the opening act for the Allman Brothers for the rest of their right. career. They, you know, they wanted to do their own thing. So, and they made a really good decision when they finally did get a record contract. They hired a guy to produce them by the name of Al Kooper.
Yes.
And Al Kooper is a badass. And yeah. he's an amazing producer. But my thing with him, the way I think of him, his big claim to fame in my world, is that he's the guy that played organ on Like a Rolling Stone, Bob Dylan's song Like mm-hmm. a Rolling Stone. And he didn't know how to play organ, was the story. He was in New York. They had the sessions there. He was so bound and determined to make it and to be part of what Dylan was doing. And they were just running through, just basically rehearsing the song they're going to do. And he jumped on an organ and started hitting those. And it's all, if you listen to that organ track on that song, it's all very, basically just one note, but it's the right note and at the right time. And Dylan heard that and said, yeah, we want the kid, you know, we want the kid playing organ. So that's my kind of connection to him. I think that's a really cool story. But he ended up being the producer and did a hell of a job. He one of the things he said too, you know, I don't know if we mentioned the house that they owned, that they basically lived or rehearsed in, wrote and rehearsed in, I guess. They called it the Hell House. It was all, and maybe Nick, in your documentary, mm-hmm. they talked a little bit about the conditions in that place.
Yeah, they did. They said it was, you know, when you pull up to it, it looks like it's going to be a great place. It's a very peaceful looking place. It's, you know, kind of by the water. But they said that the mosquitoes and the snakes and all the critters and everything get in there. And they'd got broke into a couple times right after they shortly got there. They started doing their rehearsals there, but they would steal little things, like microphones and cables and stuff. Well, then bigger stuff started coming up. So they started deciding somebody every night would have to stay there.
That's right.
So that kind of was a who drew the short straw kind of deal on who'd have to stay there, because it was miserable there at night.
Yeah, that was kind of your initiation too. Mm-hmm. You had to stay up and watch and make sure somebody didn't break in the middle of the night,
yep.
which wouldn't have been too fun, I don't think.
Mm-mm. But, you know, Al Kooper did say too that one of the things that set them apart from other bands is all the rehearsal that they did. When they came in, they knew the songs, everybody knew their parts and where they were supposed to be. And they could run through this stuff at lightning speed.
Yeah, that's kind of the point I was getting to, is that they weren't a band that would improvise. Mm-hmm. Everything had been rehearsed to the point where they could play it forwards and backwards. They played in their sleep, which is different than that mm-hmm. sets them apart from a band like the Allman Brothers, because the Allman Brothers were all about improvising, more of a jazz type thing, and that's what I think that the people that were fans of the Allman Brothers were really into, is that you go see them. Each night is going to be different. Mm-hmm. They're not going to play the same songs, but they're not going to play in the same way each time. Lynyrd Skynyrd was not like that. They were a well-oiled machine, and they knew exactly each note. And some of their songs are terribly long, but mm-hmm. they had every little section of those songs rehearsed where they could go in there and record them and knock them out in no time.
See, and on what I saw, Al Kooper actually was talking about Sweet Home Alabama. Said that when Ronnie called him, that it was actually that the album before that was going into pressing, where that week was going to be pressed. And Ronnie called him and said, hey, we've got a new song. I want to come out and play it for you. I like the way it is right now, and I'm afraid it'll change before the next album can come out, and I don't want it to change. So he comes out and plays it for him. He said, I think we got a hit.
So. Yeah, I guess that's he had the fear that if they start playing it live, mm-hmm. which that I guess that happens with bands, mm-hmm. especially if they haven't put it on a record. Mm-hmm. When it's recorded, it's set in stone. Mm-hmm. But if it hasn't been recorded, you can kind of change it up. So he was probably right. It would have changed if they had continued to play it out on the road. Yeah. I don't think it would have added to it, or maybe it would have taken something away. But
for the record, my least favorite Lynyrd Skynyrd song.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's probably just because of how much it's played.
Maybe. It's a damn good lick, though.
No,
all kinds of guitar stuff in there, that song, which most Lynyrd Skynyrd songs are great for guitarists. It's so much stuff.
And what I saw about that song is that Ed King had showed up late for rehearsal, and he walked in, and Alan Collins was in there playing a little lick on there. And so he just picked up his Stratocaster and plugged it in and played that the iconic opening lick in there to bounce off of what he was doing. And Ronnie was sitting over there giving them the circle hand motion to keep going. and he started writing the lyrics, and he'd got a chorus and a verse wrote, and he said, all right, I'm going fishing. I'll be back in about an hour. And he went down there to went and fished, and said that he could hear them from where they were at. He finished it and came back in, and they laid it down.
Yeah. There. I guess that's how they – it's a pretty amazing thing that that's how they would write a lot of their songs. The band guys would just bring stuff that they had been working on, and they would play it, and they would just lay on a couch and listen, and then – then, you know, if they play that same thing over and over for 20 minutes, he'd a lot of times come up with a melody to it and the words.
Yeah, and they said he didn't write anything down.
I have.
I don't know. Did they say it in yours too?
Yeah, Bob Barton said he said if it wasn't good enough to remember, it just wasn't very good.
Yeah.
Sounds like.
Yeah. You can't do that much drugs and drink and not have to write something down.
Well, I think in the early days, they didn't have that issue. Yeah. You know, they talked about that Hell House thing. That was, they were very strict about, we're here to work.
Right.
And we want to make it. There's no jacking around.
That's what they're saying. They were actually up early.
Yeah.
And they're,
for,
you know,
12 hours a day.
Yeah.
Rehearsing and writing. And then, of course, that whole, the drugs and alcohol thing kind of got away from them. So, what are we up to? Basically, the first album, we should talk about, Nick, you can probably talk about how there's some controversy about how the actual name of Lynyrd Skynyrd came
about. Yeah, there's like another deal, conflicting reports on it. Obviously, their school gym teacher's name was Lynyrd Skynyrd, and he would give Gary Rossington grief about his hair, and I guess he walked out at one point. And then there's the Camp Granada song, if any of y'all know that out there too, that apparently mentions Lynyrd Skynyrd in it, but they... from what they said in this documentary, that it would be a running joke with them where they would say, who are you on the phone with? And like, oh, I'm talking to Lynyrd Skynyrd. Or who's that outside? Oh, that's old Lynyrd Skynyrd. And when they decided that they needed a – because they said that the one – at that point they were using the 1% or band name, and they said that people were starting to say maybe it's 1% talent. So Ronnie said we needed to change the name. And so Bob Burns said, let's call it Lynyrd Skynyrd. And he said, where? He said, no, the band. Let's call it Lynyrd Skynyrd. And then he said, yep, that's it. That's what we're calling it. That's the story that I've been given anyway.
That sounds like a reasonable story, that they had an inside joke and and they turned it into, you know, the first album. Because when Al Kooper, he told the story when he first saw them play, he saw their name up on the sign outside, and he was like, Lynyrd Skynyrd. He was like, what the hell is this about? And then, of course, it got corrected on the name. But he's the one that came up with, you know, if you look at the first album, it's called pronounced Lynyrd Skynyrd, and tells you how to Skynyrd, tells you how to basically pronounce it using like the standard dictionary. And that was his idea, because he's like, nobody's going to know how to pronounce the name of the band. This is dumb. So let's put that on there.
That's a cool album title too.
It's a great album cover. It's a weird album.
Yeah.
Album title, but it was wise for their first album to.
But it was a great album.
It was a great album.
It was
great album.
It was, and I got to say, their second album, to name it Second Helping. That's
another good title.
That's a
man.
Great name.
Maybe we should play. Are we planning on playing some songs? Mm-hmm. What do you got from their first album?
Well, I got the one we started with.
Yeah,
this I Ain't the One. We'll play a little bit of that. That's the first track right off the album.
Again, killer guitar work. We'll be right back.
All right.
Yeah, so that's, I mean, right off the bat, that's the first track you hear off their first album. That's a pretty hell of a start.
What I like is the punchiness of their guitars, man. Yeah. Everything was, it's just in time. And when you have Gibsons and Fenders
mixed together,
yeah. I mean, it's just, it's amazing.
Yeah.
It is amazing. Between the humbuckers and the pickups and everything. I mean, it's just really cool, man. They had their own sound.
There's no doubt that was something that they consciously did. Ed King even talked about how they, when he first came into the band, the story that he told was that he was in a group prior to Lynyrd Skynyrd called the Strawberry Alarm Clock, which is part of the, there was this term I hadn't heard before, but there's a genre of music called Sunshine Pop, sometimes called LA Sunshine Pop. And it was about 67, 68, something like that. And it's, there's like good vibrations, that kind of sound, real poppy, almost bubblegum.
Almost bubblegum.
Almost.
Yeah.
And he was in the, you know, if anybody knows that Strawberry, does anybody remember Strawberry Alarm Clock? Remember?
No.
Do you know their one hit?
No. No, I sure don't.
Me either.
No?
No.
Incense and Peppermints?
Still, you don't remember that?
And then some peppermints and blah, 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 blah.
And that's absolutely free on KBOK podcast.
Well, anyway, that's a cheesy song. And I mean, that's a classic song just because it was from that era.
Sure.
So he was
definitely had AM all over it.
I'm sure. Yeah. And I'm sure.
Well, that's about all there was.
I think the story with that is that the Strawberry Alarm Clock has an odd story in that they had the band and everything, and they had an ex-manager or somebody put together a band calling themselves Strawberry Alarm Clock and was touring down the south in the south as a Strawberry Alarm Clock, but they weren't the band. And the real band got wind of that and said, well, you shut it down. And they said, well, we need some money, they already got this tour book, let's go do it. So they end up doing the tour that the fake Strawberry Alarm Clock band had already been booked to perform. And that was one night where he met Ronnie Van Zant, and Ed King told him, you know, if you ever need a need a guitar player, you know, give me a call. Well, they didn't need a guitar player; they lost their bass player, and he agreed to join the band and play bass for him. He wasn't happy about it, and he was from California. These guys are from the South, real South, Jacksonville, and so there was kind of some issues. He was the one that first did the rehearsal thing. He's the one that had to stay up all night and
watch his initiations.
Alligators and God knows what over else.
He said he had to do a week out there.
Oh, was it a week?
That's a solid week.
So anyway, so when eventually they get their other bass player back and he moves over to the guitar, and that's where you have that sound. He was a Strat guy. Everyone else was playing Gibsons, you know, Les Pauls generally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah, that's a key part of their sound is that mix, that blend of these two types of guitars. It's subtle to probably the average listener, but it really makes a huge difference. Because think about it, if they have three guitar players and they're all playing the same guitar, you're not going to be able to – there's not enough difference between everyone.
Right.
And yet, sure. You could have one playing slide, which they did a lot. But
yeah.
It was mainly a Strat, but I think he also played a Telecaster occasionally.
Well, they influenced a lot of great bands, man, that popped up over the years. After them, they tried to, I hate to say the words copycat, but they definitely did copycat the sound.
Oh, the other bands that came after?
Oh, yeah.
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 That's a good luck with that. I mean, they can try. But they
came damn close.
They tried, yeah.
So Skynyrd is really the pioneers of that sound.
They were, in my opinion, they were a very original band. I play a game when I listen to music. I always try to pick out. Either somebody's ripped a melody off or a beat or even a guitar lick or a drum beat or anything. And I'm generally pretty good about picking that stuff up. And I can't, maybe Lynyrd Skynyrd has influences beyond my knowledge, but the only thing I could ever say about that is that they would sometimes cannibalize their own stuff. Mm-hmm. And you would have a couple songs that would have, not the whole song, but there'd be a guitar riff or something that would remind you of a previous song. But that's just because that's what the, how that band mm-hmm. sounded. You know, that sounded good to them, I think.
Signature sound.
Yeah, I don't think they were purposely saying, hey, we're going to pull this lick from Give Me Three Steps and we're going to drop it in here.
Right.
You know, but they did that.
They did do that. They made it work in their favor.
Yeah, yeah. It worked every time.
You know, I was talking about the punchiness of their guitars and everything. Give Me Back My Bullets.
Yeah.
Right there. Boom. Enough said. I mean, from the very beginning, it's a cool song. It starts off with the punchiness, man.
So that first album that we played, I Ain't the One. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows that. Tuesday's Gone, another great song. Give Me Three Steps, Simple Man. That's the first four songs on that album.
Yep.
Songs that still get played on rock radio today.
Yeah, that's right.
And the very last song, Freebird.
Freebird, that's right.
Yeah.
The most requested song in every bar.
I'll give you a little taste of Freebird. For all of you yelling right now at the radio, Freebird. We could let that go on for another 24 minutes. That is
a lengthy song.
It is. It is. They talk in the documentary too about when they first wrote that song and everything. It didn't have the big guitar solo in it, and that grew over time to be 3 minutes, 6 minutes, and in some shows, 20-minute long guitar solos.
It turns into a hell of a jam fest,
man. You know what's weird is that calling out Freebird has been kind of turned into a joke. You know, you'll be at some little bar or something, some asshole will yell out Freebird.
Sure.
I had a friend of mine that was in a local band, and it was a covers band that they would do covers, and they would do – it had a few originals, and that would happen to them or something. Just, you know, ironically, Freebird! You'd hear it from the background. Of course, they don't know Freebird. Well, he decided he was going to learn all Freebird, the whole song. And the next time some asshole called out Freebird, by God, he was going to play them all, well, you said 24 minutes. And I'd watch them do it. Somebody would call out Freebird, and they would play it to him. You want to hear Freebird, buddy? You're going to hear the whole thing. And they did a great version. The guy was a phenomenal guitar player, and he could do the whole the whole thing. It's kind of.
It is a great song, though.
It is.
It is.
And it can be played in anger to shut the guy up in the audience.
It can be played in love, and it can be played
That's
in anger.
That's right. So we made it to, we got through the first album, second album.
Yeah, Second Helping.
Second Helping, which you had mentioned is a good title for.
For your second album.
For your second
album. Wouldn't be a good title for your third album.
That's, well, if you wanted to play a joke on everyone. Yeah. So in that leadoff track is Sweet Home Alabama, which is the, if you think of Lynyrd Skynyrd, if you talk to the average guy on the street, that's the song that everybody yeah. knows.
He said, turn it up, so I got you. Taste of Sweet Home Alabama right there. That's a it's an iconic song.
It is, and it has a, you know, there's some controversy with that song. Not just that a lot of people know the story about how it basically was written as a response to, at least partially, maybe not even partially, maybe totally, as a response to Neil Young's song Southern Man, and then also he has mm-hmm. a song called Alabama. So that's a reference in there where he says Neil, you know, I hope Neil Young will remember the Southern Man doesn't need him around anyhow. And in those two Neil Young songs, they were, and you got to remember Neil Young's a Canadian, so mm-hmm. what the hell's he know? So he's writing, he wrote these songs about basically chastising the attitude in the South. He considered them, you know, extremely racist, which, you know, okay. Mm-hmm. But so Ronnie Van Zant took some little exception with that, and he just wrote a song, not maliciously, I don't think. It was just kind of a, kind of just a, his basic response right. to what Neil Young had written, and they asked Neil Young about it. You know what he thought, and his only response was, he said, oh, "I like how them boys play their guitar," and that was his. And he's right. You know, he wasn't going to get into a back and forth with Lynyrd Skynyrd, but yeah, that's kind of the inspiration for that song was Neil Young. And then he gets, you know, there's obviously other things in that song that are somewhat controversial too, but we need to go into that. Because they were not without controversy. You know, one of the other big things they had was when they decided to perform with the they considered it the rebel flag, with the Confederate right. flag behind them on stage. Right. They had to have a giant flag come down.
I'm curious on what you saw on their reasoning for that, because the reasoning I was given was, I when I heard it, I thought, I don't know. They said that they were over in Europe, and the European fans over there would call them Yanks, because they call everybody from the States Yanks. And yeah. they would say, no, we're from Southern America. And they're like, yeah, you're Yanks. And
yeah,
so,
right.
So then we started flying the rebel flag behind us.
Sure.
Because
it wasn't nothing. They're not racist.
Yeah.
It was more about where they come from.
They did acknowledge later in the documentary, though, that they do understand that some people view sure. that as a sign of hate and everything. So they weren't oblivious to that.
No. I think they pretty quickly got some pushback on that.
Yeah.
And, you know, what was weird is there were a couple different stories. One, the first story they came up with was that that was something that the record company suggested. Mm-hmm. They want everybody to know that these guys, this is a Southern man, they're from the South, and so this mm-hmm. is – you know, this is an image that will let everyone know that. And Al Kooper said no. He said, no, there's no way a record company is going to suggest that. He said it was them. They wanted to do that, and they did it. That's what they wanted to do. So who knows? I tend to believe Al Kooper mm-hmm. because I don't think maybe the record company's idea was to create controversy, to create, you know, some sort of – I don't know.
It's just a gimmick. And, you know, you'll see a lot of our musicians do it. They'll have their, like, I don't even know who I want to throw out as an example. Just say Guns N' Roses. They'll have their big banner behind them with their iconic logo and stuff on it. It's just a gimmick. It's a branding deal.
Tom Petty did the same thing in the early 80s. He had the same, basically the same backdrop. And he later apologized for doing that too. I don't know if we'll get into that controversy, but I don't know that it was necessary. But some people do. Some people are greatly offended by it. But I don't. That wasn't Lynyrd Skynyrd's
intention to
hurt people's feelings.
Right.
They probably didn't really even understand that mindset. I don't think they would have done that if they had understood that.
Yeah, I mentioned them being over in Europe. That ties right into the next thing I was going to talk about on there. I don't know if they covered that on yours or not, about Bob Burns having his nervous breakdown over there.
Yes, they did. And it's a sad, sad story.
Yeah. Yeah, I was watching it through the second time. I caught something I didn't catch the first time. It's whenever Cooper wanted to do the second album in California.
Yeah, yeah.
And they went and saw The Exorcist. Did they cover that?
Oh, no, they didn't mention that.
That's when Bob Burns started taking a turn. It freaked him out. It really freaked him out. He thought his wife was the devil. He thought his cat was the devil. And he really started taking a turn there.
Well, he described it as they were working too much and he was exhausted.
Yeah.
And it was affecting him physically where he couldn't play. And they did a show somewhere in Europe and he didn't play well. And on the ride to the next place, I guess Ronnie Van Zandt just tore into him and he went crazy. They didn't necessarily describe exactly. They just said he went insane. Basically, he completely broke down and Ed King, I hate to tell this story, but he mentioned it. There was one point, I guess, in a hotel that Bob Burns took a cat and threw it out the fifth story window.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he just went completely nuts. And so, that was kind of the end of him.
Yeah. Wow. And he was replaced by Artemis Pyle, which I didn't call Artemis Prime. I said before we went on the air.
I was waiting.
I knew I was going to slip up.
Let's go back just a second. Right before they did that European tour, they switched. They fired their original manager. He was a guy that had been around them. He was like a guy. It was more of a babysitter than he was a manager. He kept them out of trouble. Anytime they got in trouble with the law, I mean, he was there.
Carried around a briefcase of money to bail them out.
He had to, or they would go into hotels because they were on the road. They were making money and a lot of drinking and drugs and everything. As a matter of fact, he described that once they started picking up steam and they would show up and do these shows, that the promoters knew, these guys like to party, so that backstage they'd have cases and cases of beer and they'd have every liquor, bottles of whiskey and everything you could imagine. And he said that these guys, it was like they got in their mind that all that they had to consume all of that.
Yeah.
It had to all be gone, If you're going to have that out there for me, and we're not going to waste it. So that was a huge problem. But anyway, so they fired that guy, and he had helped them. They'd go into – he told the story. They went into a hotel. They were in Chicago, I think, and they checked into this hotel. And as they're going to the rooms, the exit signs that are hanging from the ceiling, they bashed them and destroyed them all. Well, and the manager comes up and says, "You guys got to leave." Well, turns out that was the last hotel open in Chicago, because there was some big convention going on or something. But he was constantly, having to bail these guys out. So they fired him, and they hired this British manager who was also the manager of the Who, I believe, because it was the Who and this big guy. And one of the things that really broke them was opening up for the Who. That seems like an odd bill to me. The Who, and then you have Lynyrd Skynyrd opening.
Yeah.
But the reason
that was their big break.
That was one of their huge, it was a huge break because it was a lot of exposure.
That's right.
And what happened was Al Cooper described that he was in a recording studio somewhere, maybe in New York, and Pete Townsend was there and he said, "Hey, we're getting ready to go out. We're going to tour the Quadrophenia album. We need an opening band. Do you know anybody?" He goes, "Yeah, as a matter of fact, I do." And he handed them the second album. He said, "I think these guys could do a pretty good job for you." Next day, Pete Townsend calls him and says, "Yeah, these guys are great. Book it." And so that's when that was really one of the things that pushed them to be a giant band, was opening up for the Who. And that manager ended up being bad news. he was as bad as they were as far as drugs and everything.
You going to play him another song, man?
What do you got?
I can. I've got a bunch here.
You're going to play something off of...
play something off of Second Helping.
Here we go.
Well, work, I, what do you got? I would suggest working for MCA.
I got it right here.
Gotcha.
Another good one.
It's kind of a punk rock thing to do, write a song about your record label.
Yeah, a little bit.
Bad. Yeah. Six Pistols ended up doing that too.
So, you know, another thing about Skinner was, you know, them and Hank Williams Jr. used to hang out quite frequently.
Yeah.
Which I thought, you know, that's pretty cool.
They probably did a lot of shows together, I would imagine. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. 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 But
they still do, as a matter of fact.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, they do. Yeah. They're doing their
their final farewell tour.
In quotes.
But yeah, I mean, that's pretty cool, man.
Yeah.
I mean.
Well, I mean, in one of the recordings of Ronnie Van Zandt in there, and he's describing Lynyrd Skynyrd, he kind of does the reverse of what our friend Chad Solins does. He always says, we're a rock band that plays country music. And he always says, we're, you know, Ronnie Van Zandt more describes it as we're a country band that plays rock music.
Yeah.
So, I can definitely see that. So we're up to, what, 1974, the third album.
Yep.
Nothing Fancy.
Nothing Fancy, and that was...
And it wasn't.
Yeah.
It didn't do very well. And no. I think part of it was they weren't prepared. You think about with a band, especially a band that didn't get record their first album for 8 years, they have all that time to write music. Maybe their second album, they have some songs that are left over, or they're, you know, they're still got their creative juices going. And then by the third album, it's like, ooh. Yeah. We got to come up with some stuff, fellas. And they don't have the connection to the Hell House thing where they're all together, you know, now because they're making money. They're buying their own homes or they're, you know, have girlfriends and they're doing their own thing.
They come in off the road.
They didn't do the routine.
That's right.
It's like trying to herd cats.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Then they all come back together and they just try to.
They have all these
piecemeal it.
These hangers on.
Yeah,
drug absolutely. Dealers and everybody, old friends that they hadn't seen. And 20 years all of a sudden pop up on their
doorstep. Coming out of the woodwork.
So, hey, we'd like to come on down. Oh, yeah, come on down to the studio. And sure. You're not going to get anything done.
Right, yeah. Right. So what are the tracks on that album?
Well, the only real noteworthy song on there, as far as I'm concerned, is Saturday Night Special. As far as, you know, the well-known popular ones off that album. Whiskey Rock and Roller is, I think, the best song on that album. But Saturday Night Special's pretty solid too,
which is probably based on real live events because they were known to carry pistols with them in case they had trouble.
Yeah.
So what are the other tracks, man? Read them off.
Those are the only two.
This
is a two track album.
It's the only two I have on here.
Saturday Night Special is the lead off track, and you got Cheatin' Woman, Railroad Song, I'm a Country Boy, On the Hunt, which is a good song.
It is a good song.
I Am Losing, Made in the Shade.
It's a good song. Hank Williams Jr. covered that one.
Whiskey Rock and Roller.
Same one?
Mm-hmm.
Are you sure?
Exact same one.
100% positive?
100% positive.
I'm going to have to do some research.
Do some research.
Okay.
I'll bet you a beer.
Out of that pop machine. Right? I'll use your nickel to give it to you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is the exact same song. Cheating Woman, that's not a bad song, man. That's one of those blues songs like we were talking about earlier.
It's not a horrible album.
But it's just a different vibe.
But if you compare it to the first two.
Yeah, it's a different vibe.
Yeah.
Yeah, they kind of mellowed it down a little bit. There's still some pretty hot tracks on there, but you can tell they mellowed it down.
They had their sophomore slump on their third album.
That's true, yeah. So the next album is a live album called One More From the Road, mm-hmm. which is kind of maybe an album kind of hold everyone over until they can, kind of recollect themselves. And it's a decent live album. And I think a lot of, maybe even it's the version of Freebird that you hear mm-hmm. a lot of times is the live version of it on the radio.
Yeah.
So then you've got, Give Me Back My Bullets.
Yep.
Which this is the album that, if I remember correctly, this is the album where Ed King was gone.
Yeah, he apparently there was an incident in a hotel where Ronnie Van Zant, according to Ed King's story, broke a lamp and held the broken glass up to his throat, threatened to push him up against the wall and threatened him, and then he packed his stuff shortly after and left.
Well, in the what I saw is that he talked about how things were chaotic. The band was just having all kinds of troubles on the road, and everybody was out of control. And
he was kind of the outcast too, though.
He was, but he was the I think some of the band members saw him as a more reasonable mm-hmm. guy. He had his issues too, but there was all this constant complaining from management and the record label, blah blah blah. And Ronnie Van Zant told him, listen, I'm done with this. From now on, you make the decisions. I want you to, come talk to me and run things by me, but I want you to make the decisions on going forward, what we're going to do. And Ed King was like, we got to get off the road. So we're too tired. This is a crazy environment. We got to at least take a month off. So he went back to management, the record label, and said, all right, this is what we're going to do. We're going to take a month off. Well, record label and the management didn't want to hear that. We had gigs that are booked here. You guys need to get on the road and make some money. So within a month, he was out of the band because management mm-hmm. went to Ronnie Van Zant and said, oh, you got to get this guy out. Who knows what they said? He said this about you, or he did this or whatever. And they didn't fire him. He pretty much got the message that he wasn't wanted in that band anymore. So he left.
Yeah.
That's the story.
And that's where enters Steve Gaines.
That's right.
The Okie.
The Okie. Who, whose sister was one of the backup singers for Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Another Okie.
That's right. Two Okies in them.
Two Okies in the Skynyrd band.
And he kind of revitalized the band. He was a younger guy. And they said that...
Great guitar player.
A phenomenal guitar player. A lot of energy. And he was excited about being in this environment.
He was a Strat guy.
He pretty much had to be because he was taking Ed King's place.
He had to fill them shoes.
And the rest of the band kind of felt like they had to be on their best behavior around him because they didn't want to let him down. Don't let the kid, see us doing a big pile of coke or something backstage. We're going to be on our best behavior. And so kind of got them lined out for, at least for a little while.
Temporarily.
Sure.
Should we play him something off Give Me Back My Bullets?
Yeah. Well,
how about the title track?
Okay, that's right pretty here. Much the song that everyone's going to know.
Here we go.
That's right. Here you go. Working like a one-man man do. And I've got my love America's Bullets.
It's a great song, man.
It is.
Like I said, that's the punch.
Yeah.
And they have the punchy guitars in that song for sure, man.
For sure. Also on that album's Double Trouble, which I love that song too.
Yeah, that's a great song.
So that
I should have wrote that on my
list. That's a Dutch and Daryl
song. Did I
write
that on my list?
So that was 76 when that album came out. So
one more.
So they're kind of back on track. We got this young hotshot guitar player in the band. It's kind of revitalize them, and they record what ended up being their final album, in which was released in 77, called Street Survivors.
Yeah.
And most people know the story of, you know, the plane crash.
Sure.
And I'm sure, and Nick, the documentary that you watched, it kind of went through the describing what happened. And the net of it is that it was completely avoidable. Mm-hmm. They were doing, I guess they were doing some big shows, and they needed to go from, you know, quickly from one area, couldn't take a bus. I think their destination was Baton Rouge. Is that?
I think
correct?
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Yeah. So they had this plane that they had rented, which was a pretty good sized plane.
It was, oh, yeah. It was a passenger.
It was large enough to carry 26 people, I think, sure. Was its capacity. And they had it full. But there had been some issues with this plane. There was controversy about the pilots that maybe weren't.
They were drinking.
Maybe.
They'd been seen,
I don't think they weren't drinking at that day.
No, but they had been seen drinking. No,
there had
at
been
other
mechanical
times.
Mechanical issues.
Though. Yeah. Sure. And Aerosmith, the management of Aerosmith had actually inspected the plane prior to them renting it and decided it was not airworthy, so they declined.
But and Skynyrd picked it up.
And I think it has a lot to do with that manager that they had. I think lots of blame to go around, but he was the one that said, this is the plane we want. It was probably on a budget. You know, there's a plane that nobody else wants, but
sure.
Leonard Skynyrd will take
it. It'll get us there.
And they had flown in it several times before, and at one point they had seen some flames coming out of one of the engines.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Which generally is not a good sign.
Right.
And so even after this, they say, well, we're gonna get in this thing one more time. We're going to fly, get our load up. We're going to go to Baton Rouge.
Yeah.
And we'll take care of it there. Mm-hmm. We don't have time to wait for this thing to go, you know, have done whatever it needed to have done. So they took off. And I think that maybe that engine that was basically flaming out was probably consuming more fuel than
they ran out of fuel.
And that's pretty much
exactly what happened.
So you either have that, the engine that's consuming fuel at a rate that the pilots hadn't anticipated, or the pilots themselves didn't check the fuel.
Well, from what I read on it today, the pilots had been like taking a dipstick to check the fuel level before they would take off and everything. And they failed to do it on that last and final flight. They failed to check the fuel level, and they just assumed that there was enough in there to get them to wherever it was they were going.
That's pretty basic stuff for flying on a plane.
Right. But once it was the '70s.
Still, there's basic stuff you do. You climb
oh,
up.
Yeah. Oh,
you get a little ladder. You climb up. Those things probably have their tanks.
And you never know. They may have been on a time crunch. I mean, nobody really knows.
No.
Gary Washington says that they lost an engine. And then he went up to the front of the cockpit up there and said, hey, are we going to be able to – we're going to be okay on one engine? And they said, you need to go sit down and buckle up. We're going to try to make an emergency landing. And he said when they were going through the trees, he said you could hear them. The closer they'd get, snap, 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 snap. And it was, he said it was.
Oh, they dropped. Yeah, they were, you know, up above the clouds. They dropped down. And once they got below cloud level, they were basically on top of trees.
They were like 10 minutes away from their destination or so.
I don't know about that, but they were very close to a smaller strip that they had found that they were going to try to do an emergency landing on.
They were within. So they're hundreds of yards.
They're skimming the tops of these trees, and they said it sounded like somebody beating the bottom of the plane with baseball bats.
Yeah, that's exactly what they said.
And for some reason, these pilots decided to put the landing gear down, and that's what hooked on the trees, and that's what basically put them in a 45-degree angle right into the ground.
Yeah,
they might more of them had probably would have survived had they not done that. Maybe found a place to do kind of a belly landing somewhere, even if they had dropped down through the trees.
Right. Once again, it was the '70s.
Yeah, it was a horrible deal.
One bad mistake led into the other,
and six of the 20 people passed away, including the two pilots, Ronnie Van Zant, Steve Gaines and his sister
Cassie. Cassie Gaines.
Yeah. And their tour manager.
And that pretty much spelled the end of Lynyrd Skynyrd
for a number of years.
And it was a pretty tragic thing that happened. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know at what point his brother decided that he was going to resurrect Lynyrd Skynyrd and go out and as a tribute to his brother.
Like 86 is when they did the reunion album and tour deal.
Yeah. So they've been pretty much on the recording and on the road since then. And now they're down to what, just one?
I believe there's only one original.
Original member. Yeah.
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 So.
Yeah. I think one of them, maybe it was Bob Burns. I'm not sure. One of them died a year or two ago.
Yeah. Bob Burns did pass away, I think, in 2015.
Oh, okay. It was longer than that.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Is it, I guess we should have looked, is it Gary Rossington that's still alive?
Yes.
I think
yeah,
so.
He's the last original member of Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Yeah, he was the founding member with Ronnie Van Zant. So Johnny Van Zant, his brother, is the one that's...
That's right.
And he does sound similar. I mean, I will say that as far as their voice tone and everything goes, it's a similar sound. I've started to go see Lynyrd Skynyrd, but I've always been like, well, that's not actually Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Right.
One of the news reports they played, though, after the crash, it's, 70s, old news reporter on there, he's like, there's actually no one named Lynyrd Skynyrd in the band. So for people asking if Lynyrd Skynyrd has died, Ronnie Van Zant is the singer.
Right.
And he has passed away.
Yeah, they had to give you the disclaimer to people that
who passed away.
We've lost a lot of greats due to plane crashes, man.
Well, that was a bad one.
Yeah, that was a bad one.
It's kind of one of them deals. We say every time we lose big musical acts like this, if you can imagine the impact they would have had if they could have kept going.
Oh, yeah.
But you don't know. They could have imploded a year later and said, screw this. We're not working together anymore. But
sure. They all would have gone on to do.
Yeah.
Ronnie Van Zant would have been doing something.
They would have been doing something else and making big strides doing that. So either way.
But off that album, Street Survivors, that we're talking about, wanted to play this one. Got that smell right here for you.
Okay, I got a real quick question, man.
Seven.
No.
Okay.
everybody at this table can remember certain songs, where they were, when those songs were being played, and stuff like that. Okay, we're talking about Lynyrd Skynyrd. What's the very first Lynyrd Skynyrd song you remember hearing?
Me?
Dig back.
Give Me Three Steps. Is probably the first one I remember. That's my mom playing it on vinyl at the house.
Yep.
Growing up, she played Lynyrd Skynyrd nonstop. But that's the first one I've.
I don't have as good of a story. Probably Sweet Home Alabama on the radio.
Mine's easy.
Yeah,
because I can remember it like it was yesterday.
That's why you asked the question because you had a good response.
Oh yeah. Well, most people that ask a question usually
I had a shitty response. So
I'm sorry. Didn't mean to throw you under the bus. My dad had the machine shop when I was growing up, and a guy by the name of Kendall Smith worked down there, and, you know, he was the Camaro-driving, redneck, car-racing kind of guy. It was, "What's Your Name?" Oh. It came on, and I was like, "That's a pretty cool song. Who is that?" And he said, "Lynyrd Skynyrd." And I said, "What the hell's a Lynyrd Skynyrd?" Yeah. And that was what introduced me to Lynyrd Skynyrd. And I was a fan from day one, man.
That would have been a good concert t-shirt back in the day. "What the hell's a Lynyrd Skynyrd?"
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, "What's Your Name?"
Huh.
And that song has not really been talked about very much either, but there's a hell of a storyline to that song, too.
Oh, yeah?
Sure.
Sure. What is it?
No, I'm just talking about the lyrics.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, if it was based on a true story, I mean, that's pretty cool.
I'm glad you said that, because Ed King said, you know, people always ask him, what was Rodney Van Zant about? You know, what was he like? And he said, well, all you have to do is read the lyrics to 6 songs that he wrote, and that'll tell you everything you need to know about Rodney Van Zant. Because he put it all in his song lyrics.
Okay, so what are the 6 songs?
Well, he said it didn't matter. Any six.
Just picks any 6.
Any 6 songs that he wrote the lyrics to, that would tell you
everything. Say that fast. Pick any 6.
Yeah. That's it. And I think there's a lot of truth to that.
Yeah. That's good. That's how you know you're being an authentic, real
true. Yeah. I mean, there was a guy, he wrote about what he knew, which is that's what they tell every author, write about what you know.
Well, a clip from an interview that he did in that documentary, he says in there, you know, "I try to keep my lyrics simple because I feel if I can appeal to more people with simple lyrics that everybody can relate to, then."
Plus, he has to memorize them all because he apparently doesn't write them down.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sure.
Yep.
Yep. You gotta get them on. You gotta get them out there somehow.
That's right.
Well.
Okay. So I think that wraps up Lynyrd Skynyrd.
I mean, that's pretty definitive end.
That's it. Yeah, it did have a definitive end.
Yep.
So everybody run out and listen to Lynyrd.
That's right. Or go find, if you want, I mean, this may be your last chance to see at least one founding member and Rodney Van Zant's brother, and I'm sure a great band that can, I've been on the road a long time. Yeah. If you want to hear the best version of those old songs done live, I don't think you could do any better than that.
And I think, too, Ricky Medlock's playing with them now, and he had at different points, he had played with Lynyrd Skynyrd early on, and he's back with them now, too. So,
gotcha.
So you've at least, you've got 2 and a brother.
Yeah.
So you've got a decent amount of Skynyrd there to go see. So get out and go see him if they're in your area. Be sure to rate, review, subscribe to this podcast, everything. And we'll see you on the next one. We were going to do a round table here at the end of everybody saying our top 5 Skynyrd songs. Right. So we'll let Brett go first.
Okay. So I'm going to say, and this is in no particular order, "Tuesday's Gone."
Mm-hmm.
Great song. "I Know a Little." "Give Me Back My Bullets." "I Ain't the One." And "The Ballad of Curtis Lowe."
Oh, those are great ones.
Go ahead, Nick.
Okay, well, I'm stealing 2 from Brett because they were on my list anyway.
Yeah.
"I Ain't the One" and "Tuesday's Gone" are both on mine.
Yep.
But then I'm also going to go down here and I'm going to go with "Don't Ask Me No Questions." Well, that one, "Needle in the Spoon." And
"Don't Ask Me No Questions."
There's so many good ones. I'll say all I can do is write about it, which is it's a little different kind of Skynyrd.
You know, it's not like they had 100 songs to choose from. I mean, they didn't have a large.
They had a lot, though.
They did have a lot, but they did. But they didn't have as much as what you would really think that they had. I mean, it's not like they put out a whole lot of music.
No,
I mean,
everything 73 to 77, that's pretty much all you got.
Sure. Mine's in no particular order. And of course, I copied off of you guys because we have the same kind of taste of music. But anyway, mine's "Needle in a Spoon."
Nobody had that one.
I did.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. "I Know a Little." You had that one, Brad?
I did have that one.
"Things Going On." I don't think anybody had one. "Give Me Back My Bullets."
I had that one.
Brad had that one. "Double Trouble."
Well, I didn't have that one, but I do love that song.
I thought you said you had that
one.
Okay. All right. And "Down South Jukin."
Yeah.
That is a great song. Great song.
Huh.
Yeah. Have you ever heard that song?
I don't remember that song.
We will be listening to that here in a few minutes.
Between the 3 of us, we've put together a pretty damn good Skynyrd.
Yeah, that's pretty much the greatest hits right there.
So,
and we didn't even mention Freebird.
I appreciate Freebird. I really do too.
But
we did lift off Sweet Home Alabama and Freebird.
Yeah. Well, I established early on.
And "What's Your Name?"
That one's on.
It was a hit. It was still a hit.
I know you have your story with it and everything. But
who had Tuesdays Gone? You?
I did.
You had that one?
I had Tuesdays Gone also.
Did you?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Well, 2 out of 3. That ain't bad.
I'm going to say something blasphemous.
That's a meatloaf kind of deal.
I'm going to say something blasphemous on here, though.
Oh, don't do it.
Tuesdays Gone is one of my favorite Lynyrd Skynyrd songs, but I prefer Hank Jr.'s version of Tuesdays Gone.
Yeah, he actually covered that song, too.
His version is
really phenomenal. I don't think I've heard that.
His voice on the song, phenomenal.
Yeah.
Probably couldn't sing it today.
Right.
Back when he did.
Oh, yeah.
It's phenomenal.
Sure. All right.
All right. I hope everybody enjoyed it. Thanks. We'll see you on the next one.
Bye-bye.
Bye.